Cheap and Cheerful. Today, I'll be covering the five things you must look at when buying any power bank. How this new Kmart Anko brand power bank stacks up. I'll be testing, opening it up, and rating. And finally, what electronics accessory should you never, ever buy? So let's go. Number one on the things we must check when buying any power bank is the capacity, obviously, how big it is. As our example, I'll be using this Kmart Anko brand power bank that I picked up for $40 US. This one claims to be 26,800 milliamp hours genuine capacity, and that's very large, but the problem with this number is the milliamp hours you'll get from a power bank depends completely on how you're going to be using it. It's like the fuel efficiency rating on cars. It's technically possible you'll get that 10,000 miles per gallon, but in real life, it's just never gonna happen. And to make matters worse, the milliamp ratings on products are often exaggerated or just plain lies. We'll be checking whether this device is telling the truth and how we can identify the real capacity and avoid fakes a little later. Number two on the things we must check is the watt hours. This device claims 96.48 watt hours, which is the amount of energy it can put out within 1 hour. And I'd encourage you to use this watt hour rating instead of the milliamp rating when comparing different power bank products. Why? It's more reliable. In fact, it's what your electricity company is using right now to charge you for the power that you're using in your home. As a general rule, all good power banks will show their watt-hour rating on the product listing or the product manual. If you can't find any watt-hour rating, then odds are the capacity has been exaggerated and you should stay away. And remember, if you plan on taking your power bank on an airplane, it can't be larger than 100 watt-hours, which is what most countries' air safety authorities have deemed safe to take on board. Number three on the things we must check is the maximum output watts. This is how powerful it is, how fast it'll charge your devices. The old Apple USB chargers that everybody seemed to have 5 or 10 years ago were just 5 watts, so they took forever to charge anything, usually overnight. A good modern USB charger are around 18 to 20 watts. So an 18 watt power bank like this Anko will charge your smartphone just as quickly as your standard USB wall charger. That's pretty quick. Cheaper power banks might only be 5 or 10 watts, so they'll take a lot longer. Number four, quick charge and power delivery. These are brand names for different types of fast charging technology. All modern devices like smartphones and tablets should support one or the other. So it's a good idea to make sure you buy a power bank that supports both. You'll usually see this on the power bank as QC/PD. Now, the final and most important thing to check when you're buying a power bank is safety. Many of us don't realize just how much energy really is contained within these little boxes. It's a massive amount, and if you've seen videos online of lithium battery fires, you'll start to get some idea. There are many ways to know whether your power bank is safe, some simpler than others, but let's go through a few of them now so you know exactly what to look for next time you're buying. The first signs are on the outside of the packaging. We have a brand. Now, a brand might not seem important to safety, but in technology, it means that a company is putting its reputation behind the device. They're going to receive a lot of bad press if this device hurts anyone.
It fried the entire computer.
So a brand is always a good first sign that a piece of technology is well made and safety has been taken seriously. Second, we have a C-tick. In America, you'll have a UL listed symbol or an ETF symbol. These are all safety certification authorities that mean the device's design has been confirmed to meet all electrical safety standards in your country. You'd be surprised how many devices are sold online that don't have any third-party checks on whether they meet basic safety requirements. And so many dodgy cheap products online that take serious risks with your life just to save a few bucks. I'll show you one of the most common ones at the end of this video and how you can avoid it. The other important indicators of safety are inside the device. So let's get stuck in. All right, so the surface is anodized aluminium. Metal cases of any type will conduct electricity, so the designers need to ensure the electronics inside are protected from touching the outer metal case. If they do touch, it could cause a short circuit and a fire. We'll see what Anko has done to protect us from this kind of problem when we open it up. Moving on, the LCD screen. Powerbanks either have an LCD screen like this to tell you exactly how much power is left, or they'll have 4 to 5 LEDs to show you approximately how much power is left. Try to buy one with a proper LCD screen. It's going to be a lot more useful. The problem with this LCD screen though, is the designers have tried to blend it in with the front metal face, but the way they've done it isn't very convincing and really only makes it harder to read the screen. It looks like they've put a transparent plastic window in front of the LCD and painted that window the same color as the metal. As a result, the screen is harder to read. And I didn't know what these symbols were for until I zoomed in on this video footage. Now, I'm going to use this for 1 month to see how it goes, and I'll report back to you the results. Alrighty, so 1.5 months later, still working. I put around 4 to 5 complete charge-discharge cycles through it. I found I didn't use it as often as my other DIY power bank, just because of the surface. I don't know, it just feels strange to me, like it's leaving a oily residue. Maybe you won't notice it at all, but for me, didn't like the feel of it, I guess, so I picked it up less often. Moving on in terms of basic stats. I've put about 4 to 5 complete charge and discharge cycles through it. Time to charge from 10% to 100% was 5.5 hours with a good quality 18 watt Type-C quick charger, such as you'd use with any modern smartphone or tablet. As for discharge time, I ran it on a variety of devices to simulate real-world usage. In total, it ran for 14 hours and 37 minutes, outputting 11,162 milliamp hours. Now, I know what you're thinking. Hey, that's not 26,000 milliamp hours. That's less than half. Does that mean they were lying about its capacity? No. Milliamp hour ratings are for the total capacity of batteries inside this device, but those batteries, they only run at 3.7 volts. To provide the 5 volts we expect from a USB port, or even the 12 volts I was pulling using quick charge, the power bank needs to boost that voltage up from 3.7 to 5 or 9 or 12 volts. This process is never perfectly efficient, meaning we lose power in the form of heat. It's the same for the cables and other electronics in here. None of them are perfectly efficient, and so there's losses along the whole journey. All the power that's lost is converted into heat energy, and so next time you pick up your phone after it's been charged very quickly and it feels warm, that temperature is all the power you've lost during the process of charging. We can see this in some of the data provided by power banks in their specifications. For example, this one where we have 30,000 milliamp hour power bank, but it quotes just 18,000 at 5 volts, the lowest possible charge setting, 12,000 at 9 volts, and 8,000 at 12 volts. What's important in the end is that the claims they make on the front of the package are correct, so the everyday person isn't being misled. In the case of the Anko, it quotes up to 850% more smartphone battery based on an iPhone 7, or 230% more tablet battery based on an iPad Air 2. Are they telling the truth? Well, the numbers seem possible to me, but very tight. Really, we need to test it with a real-world device. So that's what I'll do. I don't have an iPhone 7 or an iPad Air 2, but I do have a tablet that's very similar to the Air 2. Its battery size is almost identical. According to the packaging, we should be able to charge it 2.3 times. So let's do it. Alrighty. While we're waiting for that to happen in some other dimension, let's see how we can get into this thing. I'd wanted to do this while it was flat, as it's normally a good idea only to mess with these things when the battery is low. That way, if there are any explosions, there may be less of them. But as it happens, this thing is fully charged. So, yeah. Now, I was looking all over this for screws, and I was beginning to think that maybe it's glued together, which would really suck. Until I noticed on the top and the bottom, there appears to be a sticker. Yeah. Hopefully there's something under these stickers we can use to get inside. Oh, yeah, I'm seeing some screws. That's a good sign. Six screws. Tiny little ones. If there was any more of these, I'd be using my Show Me electric driver that I reviewed a few weeks back, link above. In that video, I look at 6 or 7 different electric drivers ranging from $15 to $50. There are some good ones out there, but you've got to buy one that suits your purpose. Otherwise, you'll end up disappointed. Link above if you're into that. Okay, it comes off. 18650s. Alrighty, look at that. I was hoping to find them inside here. I didn't want it to be one of those flat pack lithium polymer batteries. I much prefer these kinds of cylindrical cells. Why? Well, I can reuse these in all kinds of stuff, like my RC cars to make new battery packs, in torches, speakers. Is it going to slide out or is it just going to be stuck? It's easy to cut through, but if I can't reach inside to scrape it, then I won't be getting this out. So I've grabbed a plastic bottle and I've cut out a tool that I can use to shove in there and scrape out the putty. Here goes. Okay, so I've taken my Show Me screwdriver case and it was the perfect size and shape to put on the back here and push down really hard to push out the battery pack. It scratched this up a little, but that's okay. Anyway, so these are not 18650s. I thought they looked too big when I saw them from the side, and yeah, it turns out they're 20650s, 20mm in diameter and 65mm long. Now, obviously these aren't big name expensive cells like LG's or Samsung's, but they are a reputable Chinese brand. These guys make lithium ion batteries for Chinese electric vehicles, big battery storage, UAVs, motorcycles, etc. As for the cells, it has 8 3350 milliamp hour cells, equaling 26 800 milliamp hours as quoted on the product packaging. The fact it has all this information on it, the manufacturer, date, cell chemistry, and the watt hours, all this is a great sign that this is a respectable, well-made battery and not some dodgy used or recycled cell that's just been repackaged or worse. As I've shown before, cheap used batteries that may be damaged and dangerous are everywhere in the market, and some can find their way into new devices simply because they're cheap. This is the gamble you're taking when you buy cheap batteries or cheap no-brand power banks online, that it will be full of this. It's just not worth it. I'd be confident these cells are good for their capacity based on the manufacturer, the various data provided, and the performance so far. But we'll wait to see the final testing results. As for safety, it's good. We have a temperature sensor which will disconnect the batteries if they're overheating, preventing fires. And we have the whole thing covered and separated from the metal shell, with extra support for soldered joints and a cage to prevent the circuit board from rattling around or things coming loose. Inside, it's well made. I've taken many battery packs apart before, from Toshiba's to HP laptops to no-name brands, and this holds up well with the best. Everything is secure, solid, the circuit board layout is neat, and I'm not seeing any signs of cheap, dodgy manufacturer. So I'm satisfied. So finally, do their claims on the packaging stack up? Charging a full-size 10-inch tablet 2.3 times based on an iPad Air 2? Well, from my own testing, yes. I was able to deliver a full charge to my son's Samsung 10-inch tablet about 2.5 times. It's very similar in capacity to the iPad Air 2, so turns out they're telling the truth. Who'd have thought? So what have we learned? Well, to recap, number one, be suspicious of the milliamp hour claims on power banks, as that number all depends on how it's being used. Instead, use the watt hours to compare products. It's a much more reliable measure. Number two, get a power bank with at least 18 watts maximum output and make sure it states QC, quick charge, and PD, power delivery, for the fastest possible charge. Number three, and finally, for safety, buy a brand name and always look for those CTIC or UL or ETF logos so you can be sure it's been designed safely. Finally, what device should you never, ever buy that many of you will already have? You've probably guessed it, but cheap USB chargers are easily the most unsafe device commonly found in homes across the world. You will be shocked at the corners cut in manufacturing a cheap USB charger, where even the most basic components for safety are removed to save money. I'll be tearing down, taking apart one of the most popular USB chargers sold on all the major online stores and showing you exactly what is and what isn't protecting you from electrocution. Subscribe to see that one in about a week's time. Well, that's all I've got for the day. I hope you learned something. I know I did. Take care, and I'll see you next time. Bye now.